Thank you. That was nice, wasn't it? It's a good way to start a morning. So, how many of you were on the ball enough to get up and come to chapel on Monday? Show of hands. The rest of you, it was amazing. Can I just start by saying what an honor it is for you to have me here again? A real life celebrity. Almost. And one very enthusiastic person and a lot of, clapping. So on Monday, if you were not here, so I'm a performing artist, a sort of an acrobat dancer, and so I was here on Monday dancing around up there and showing you my muscles. And now what I'm about to do is appeal to your intellect, and we're going to do a little talk. Before we do, I need to say something important, which is that I'm about to say some very mean things about bad Christian art. And you're welcome. And here's the thing. I don't have a problem with bad Christian art, actually. I do a lot of bad Christian art. Bad art is how you get to good art. It all starts there, right? And I do it now. Every project that I start starts off really bad, and then I put a ton of time and effort into it and eventually perform it on the stage, and sometimes it's still bad. Some people would say that I did bad Christian art on Monday here in chapel, but those people are idiots. Because as I mentioned earlier, I was amazing, objectively. So this is my stalker in the front row. So look, if you're doing bad art, it's fine. That's part of the process, okay? And I have no problem with it. If you're in like a Christian drama group that I've been in, like in a youth group, or you're in a college club or some sort of art group or performance thing now, and sometimes you look at the script and you're like, really? Don't worry about it. Keep doing that thing. It's fine. It's a good experience, and it is how we learn. Here's what I have a problem with, okay? I have a problem that on the whole, we Christians have sort of kind of settled. And we're like, it's good enough. And then not only that, but we also think that not only are we not bad, but that we're amazing, that we're better than all those secular artists because Jesus is in our piece. And so because Jesus is on stage performing with us, then somehow it's amazing. And it just isn't. And the sad thing is that a long time ago, the church was where you went for good art, from the beautiful Gothic cathedrals to the Negro spirituals sung by black slaves who cried out from their pain and their agony directly to God from the depths of their souls. And we have left all of that behind, and now we content ourselves with making commercials for Jesus and expecting to get the same level of respect from other artists and from the industry. And it's just not going to happen. Is that okay? All right. So, when Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and horsemen went into the sea, the Lord brought the waters of the sea back over them. But the Israelites walked through the sea on dry ground. Then Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand. All the women followed her with tambourines and dancing. And Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted, the horse and the rider he has hurled into the sea." This is kind of art, right? It's music. It was a performance. It was worship from the women who were playing and singing. and dancing, it was from their heart to God's, but it also communicated something to the people. It was a public performance as well. It was a prayer of thanksgiving and an exhortation of praise enacted physically. Now, I got into drama via my church when I was a shy teenager, and we had this mantra where we would say, "It's all for the Lord, guys. This is our prayer, man." And so we would go to churches, and we would perform, and we'd say to ourselves, just ignore the people. They don't matter. This is between us and Jesus. Just focus on him. And we would perform on the streets. Oh, yes, we did. And we got heckled because we were terrible. But we loved getting heckled because we called it persecution, and it meant that we were doing something right. But we weren't doing anything right. We got heckled because we were terrible and no one understood what we were doing, and so they kind of mocked us. As an adult, I've now had to sit through some of these sorts of performances. In fact, I judged the theater category at a certain Christian convention that will remain nameless. And one year, I remember they added this judging category called ministry effectiveness. And we had to rate teenagers from their youth groups doing theater on their ministry effectiveness. And what this meant was that if people were not crying and giving their lives to Jesus, that the performers had failed and they would get marked low on ministry effectiveness. And so what this did is essentially Christians then killed comedy. And the one thing that I enjoyed about judging this is that sometimes I would get a laugh and now I couldn't laugh without feeling guilty. Because as we all know, ministry must be serious. The Bible does record that Jesus wept, but it never says that he laughed, and so we must assume he didn't, and neither should you. Look, being bad is fine, right? It doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. It is part of the learning process. Look, I'm a dad. You saw us perform this piece. My kids are, you know, old now. They're not old, they're in their 20s. Boy, you don't look old enough to have grown-up kids. Thank you. Thank you guys for thinking that inside your heads. So I have kids. I'm going to take this off to show you how serious I am. I would roll up my sleeves, but they're already rolled up. And look, I'm wearing jeans to be relatable. I'm like one of those cool youth pastors that they used to have in the 70s. So when I was a kid, when I went to, and I'm a pastor's kid, by the way, so I was the worst kind of kid, right? And on Sunday, I had to wear my best clothes, my Sunday clothes. And I hated my best clothes because they were itchy and scratchy and they fit tight and the pants were too short. And there's this horrible sweater and this awful clip-on tie. And I hated it. But then when my kids were little, my wife and I said the same thing to them. We said, Sunday is an important day. This is the day for Jesus. And to show respect, we wear our best clothes, because Jesus deserves our best. But we had one little difference, which was that with our kids, we let them decide what their best clothes were. And you know what they were? Darth Vader, Batman and Robin. My kids went to church in fancy dress, armed to the teeth. They had plastic guns and lightsabers, masks, I mean, the whole deal. And people thought we were horrible parents, which we were, but for completely different reasons. But they did this because God deserves our best, and that was an important thing to instill in them. It's not about them looking good for other people, right? It's their communication with God, and it has nothing in that moment to do with anyone else. It is not a public thing. So my question, I suppose, is if it's really all for the Lord, this thing that we're doing, okay, then why do you need me to watch you? Like, do I have to sit through your thing if it's just for the Lord? Does that make sense? Do you need me to be in the room? Could you just do it in your living room if it's just for the Lord? Now, sometimes art is prayer. Sometimes performance is worship. I have been up on stage, and sometimes it is transcendent. The audience disappears, and it feels like it's just me and God up there. And sometimes I can sit through a worship service and feel absolutely nothing. Let's define some terms here. So, what is prayer? What is worship? What is communication with God? So, well, it's just that, right? It is communication between your spirit and God's. I think in a loose definition, that's what it is. It can be words, but it could be movement, it could be music, it can be art, some art thing, or it can just happen right inside your soul. So what is art? So I think art is where technical exactitude, that is all your training, your talent, your ability, and your experience come together, that technical exactness, and your emotional vulnerability, your honesty in front of people, where those two things come together, that's where we start to create art. Now, the problem is that we sometimes get emotion mixed up with spirit. So when we pray, our emotional vulnerability, that side, all that stuff, gets all mixed up in it. And when we pray, our emotions can be involved, but they can't necessarily be relied on, right? I mean, if you feel that God is far away, that does not necessarily mean that God is far away. God understands you better than you understand yourself. And God does not need some crazy emotional display in order for him to feel loved by you. That is what we do for people. We do that for the other humans. They do need that. And so when we're communicating with people, we think about how we're coming across and how we're impacting them. With God, it's very different because he can see inside us. Emotional vulnerability, I think, has to do with being authentic in performance. Technical exactitude is about being skilled enough to say what you mean to say. It's about being clear. That's what people require. Now, art as prayer is about you, and it is about God. This is your expression of yourself in him. You don't have to be talented for God to get it. You don't have to be able to dance or sing or play an instrument. It goes beyond words, it goes beyond intellect, and it describes the cry of our soul. And he will bridge the communication gap. He gets it. And it is most honest. This stuff tends to happen in private. So Jesus went out, as usual, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." Then he withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed on his own, you guys. "Father, if you are willing to take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Now, let me show you somebody who screwed this up. Now, David, wearing a linen ephod, his underwear — I know some people argue it wasn't really underwear. It was underwear. In the culture of the time, it would have had a similar impact to you dancing around in public in your tidy whities, which I've done before as a professional, though. Now, David, wearing a linen ephod, was dancing with all his strength before the Lord. And the ark of the Lord entered the city of David. Saul's daughter Michal looked out the window. When she saw King David leaping and dancing in his underwear, she despised him. When you do this stuff in public, people are likely to misunderstand you. It's just the way it is. So here's how you do this private thing, this private dance. Do it on your own. Do it by yourself. Do it with a group of people who understand what it is that you're doing. And let that honest thing be between you and God. For performance, it's a little different. And by performance, remember, I'm talking simple. I'm not talking about faking, right? It should be still very honest. By performance, I mean that there are other people witnessing it, and you're doing it partly for them. So for performance, it's a little different. Now you are communicating with imperfect humans, and you have to bridge the communication gap. The moment that you are asking people to give up their time, or if you're a professional, their money and their time, you have to make it a conversation. It is now about them. And if you're going to do that, you may as well be good at what you do. It's okay to be good. Take your time, perfect your art over the years. Do it well. And here's a tip for those of you here that are performers of one kind or another, and kind of you all are, by the way, right? There's the thing where you learn a skill and you do your art, but look, I've performed, my biggest live audience, not like TV or film or anything, but my biggest live audience was 11,000 people in this massive amphitheater. It was a rush. It was pretty cool. But my most important performances were reading stories to my kids before bed. And I took those performances every bit as seriously as the 11,000 people think. Now, my kids don't pay me as much, but I was dancing around the room. I'm doing the voices. I'm jumping up and down on the bed. I'm engaging with these kids. With those 11,000 people, I had a very small impact on a lot of people. With my kids, I have this massive life-changing impact on just a small number of people. And so that, right there, it's a performance. Job interview, a date, meeting somebody for the first time, these are all performances of a kind. So here's a tip for you. In public performance, there are two kinds of performer. One says, look at me. Feast your eyes, people. Look at this beautiful specimen doing the art thing that I do. And then there's this other kind of performer that says, look at this with me. I'm pointing the way. There's a humility to that. And it changes our attitude. And it makes us servants. Ideally, I think, in a perfect world, in a perfect moment, art and faith unite. Your whole life could be a living prayer, a living worship every moment. It's not just something that you do in chapel or in church, but it follows you everywhere. This can only happen with good relationship, when our vertical relationship between me and God are aligned, and then for the performance part, that my horizontal relationships with other people unite. Hey, check this out. You see how I made a cross? It's Christian. So why perform for people anyway? Why do this? Well, because it's not all for the Lord. We do stuff for each other too. And we do this to leave signposts of our experiences to, in some ways, point the way. The ancient Hebrews, they left piles of rocks. They were altars. In the Old Testament, you see the same little phrase used, that say, and they built an altar there, and it's still there today. It stands there today. And it was a way of saying, this time, at this moment, God showed up. Something happened. And they put a pile of stones to commemorate that moment so that everybody else that came past would be pointed towards God. So here's what we're going to do. Oh, can I say one more thing? just before we do this little performance thing. So if you're wondering how to get started with this, the very first thing you do is look for somebody else or something else to serve. And you heard an opportunity this morning, right? I forget your name, I'm so sorry, but we have somebody who's a missionary in India who gets this, right? I don't know whether she's would consider herself to be an artist or not, but she is living a life where she is putting piles of rocks all over the place, these signposts that point back to God. And she is living life for more than just herself. That's how you start. So go to the thing after this, okay? Go do that. All right, now, I'm going to ask my performers here to come up on stage while I introduce you. Thank you. So we did a workshop yesterday. And the workshop was only 2 hours. It was very short. And we spent a lot of that 2 hours inventing and moving and trying stuff out and just sort of playing with the idea of movement theater. And then the very last 30 minutes, it was actually just a little bit less than 30 minutes, I said, hey, let's put something together. So these guys, with only like an hour and a half, hour and 35 minutes of training, and then 25 minutes of what will we do, put this thing together. And we use Psalm 23, which is the most Christian of Psalms. And I'm going to read from the King James Bible, which is, as you know, is the correct Bible. And I want you to feel this thing as their communication between them, their hearts, and God, but also something that exhorts us to learn something from this little passage and understand it a little bit in movement as well as language. My shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Great. Thank you, guys. Awesome. Beautiful. Beautiful. My wife, Heather, works as well as being a performer. Some people asked me, was that her on stage with me? And yes, it was. So she works with children as well. And she works with at-risk children as well. These are kids that are in incredibly tough situations. I have a son. You already know that, right? So one of my sons is a soldier. He's in special operations. He's seen a lot of crazy things. And we understand what PTSD is for a combat veteran. But these were first graders who were showing symptoms of PTSD. And what happens with them when their life is completely out of control, they will create chaos. Because if they're creating the chaos, they have an element of control, right? Being the center of the tornado is a survival strategy. And so we say these are bad kids. They're problem children. No, they're making the most logical response to stress given the circumstances. So Heather goes into this classroom and the kids are punching each other, like they will punch and then start crying and tell the teacher that that kid hit them just to do something. They're climbing over each other and they're fighting. And what Heather does, which is amazing, she's like the Pied Piper, except she doesn't take them away. She doesn't steal children. Although she tried, she and I went to Disney a while ago, and we're walking. She loves kids so much. She's like, do you think I could just take one? Like, there's so many kids here. Would they miss, you know, one of the cute ones? We could just take them. So I said no. So she does this thing where she whispers. She talks at a low volume. And she creates this little bubble, this little world around her. And she does it physically. It's sort of the way that she moves, the way she breathes, and the way she looks at them, which is with genuine love. And so her world becomes more interesting than theirs. And pretty much, pretty soon, they start dropping into her world. They lean into what she's saying. They get closer. She says, I know that a lot of you came here with things in your heart that are hurting you and that you're worried about. She said, but we're going to do a theater class and we don't need those things for this class. So let's do this. Everybody take out your box. She didn't say, imagine. She told them to do it. And so now they're all miming. Imagine, open it up. Close your eyes and think of the thing that is worrying you the most and take it out and put it inside the box and close the lid and tie it up with a little ribbon. She asked them what color the ribbon was and they knew. Mine's blue, pink. And then she said, let's line up by the door quietly. So here they are, 20 crazy kids in complete silence in a line holding nothing. And they go outside into the corridor, and she said, put your box on the floor in a neat line, and we'll leave it here for the class. And don't worry, if those things are really important to you, I will let you take your box back and put them back in at the end. But for this hour, we don't need it. And they went back in, and they had this amazing, rich moment. And at first, you know, at the end, some of them did leave the classroom at the end. She kept her promise, and they put that stuff back in, and it was awful to watch them reclaim that stress. But she started doing that exercise every time she went into that group of children. And an amazing thing happened, which is they started to realize, maybe I could just leave it out there. Maybe I don't need it after all. This was kind of better. And it was a little incremental step towards healing for them. So can we put the house lights up a little bit? And we're going to do this. I know you're not first graders. I know this is weird and awkward. And believe me, even though I'm a performer, when someone stands up the front and says, we're all going to do something, I'm like, please don't. Can I just sit here and watch you? No, you can't. But I do recognize it's awkward. So we're going to do this together. Stand up. This is how we'll end here. Hey, Nate, could you play that other track? It's the next piece. piece on there. I think it's Indian Summer or something, or group message. You can play it now. All right, here's what we're doing. I'm going to teach you one little move here. Put your hand up and make a quick muscle so it pops like this. This is what we're going to do when we touch our box. It's right there in front of you. Just look down at it. Put one hand on. And another little hand. And let's open the lid. We're doing this. Yeah. You opened the lid. I want you to put your hand on your heart. And for one moment, would you close your eyes? And I want you to picture the thing that is hurting you the most, the heaviest burden that you have right now, the thing that is the hardest to carry, the thing that is eating you up inside and destroying you. I want you to picture that thing coming into your hand. And you can open your eyes and pull your hand away, closed, with that thing in it. And it might be a secret, private, awful thing. It doesn't matter. It's in here. And put it inside the box. Take that lid and close it. What color is your ribbon? Wrap it around. Tie it up. Take that box. Lift it high above your head. And as you do this, I want you to picture these giant hands of God reaching down, the creator of the universe with this incredible power reaches down and he takes that box out of your hands and you let go and you bring them down. And together we take this deep breath and we let it out. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this opportunity just to stand here and do this little thing. Lord, we know it's goofy, we're just moving around, and yet it is a symbol of something that is so much deeper for us. Lord, thank you that it's no more ridiculous than us eating crappy Wegmans wafers on Sunday morning and juice and pretending that it's real alcoholic wine and calling it your body and your blood. We know that it's a symbol. We know that it's a small, insubstantial stand-in for your power and your love. But Lord, would you let this mean something to us today? As we eat lunch, as we learn, as we stress about college and our future lives, would you keep this picture in our minds that we can take out those things, our burdens, and we can put them in our boxes and we can give them one by one to you as you free us. Lord, you're beautiful. Look at what you've done for us. Thank you, Lord. Amen.